Let us stand as we are able. Nos ponemos de pie. Bendito sea Dios, Padre, Hijo y Espíritu Santo. Dios omnipotente, para quien todos los corazones están manifiestos, todos los deseos son conocidos, ningún secreto se haya encubierto. Purifica los pensamientos de nuestros corazones por la inspiración de tu Santo Espíritu, para que perfectamente te amemos y dignamente proclamemos la grandeza de tu santo nombre, por Cristo nuestro Señor.
Amén.
Gracias en nuestros corazones, oh Señor, para los que hemos conocido la encarnación de tu Hijo Jesucristo, anunciada por un ángel a María la Virgen. Seamos llevados por la cruz y pasión de Cristo a la gloria de su resurrección, quien vive y reina contigo en la unidad del Espíritu Santo, un solo Dios, ahora y por siempre.
Amén. Amén.
Se pueden sentar para escuchar las lecturas.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Again the Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear then, O house of David. Is it too little for you to weary mortals, that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son and shall name him Emmanuel." The word of the Lord. Pray with me, Canticle 15 in the Book of Common Prayer on page 91, and we shall read it in unison. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Santo Evangelio de nuestro Señor Jesucristo según San Lucas. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. El Evangelio del Señor.
Pray for me and pray with me. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, Lord, my rock, my redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. One of my New Testament professors in college often said, exegesis is, in the end, to restore the tone of the text. Well, although now I think there can be more than one tone for one text possible with our many different words in front of the text, I think my professor's claim has some truth to it. We all know "good for you" and "good for you" are not the same. But when written, it's the same three words, "good for you." Today, we are celebrating the Annunciation. I'm sure many of you have read and heard this passage countlessly. I'd like to invite you today to an attempt to reconstruct and restore the tone of the announcement that Gabriel makes to Mary and the tone of Mary's response, "Here am I, servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." What's the tone of this text you're more familiar with and people are most familiar with. Google will show you many illustrations, many paintings describing this holy announcement, classical and contemporary. And most paintings have shared two things in common, other than both Gabriel and Mary being pale white. One is the position of Gabriel and Mary. Gabriel is usually positioned higher than Mary, like Gabriel here and Mary here. So it seems only Gabriel speaking to Mary, and Mary is receiving the message. And two is the posture of Mary. Mary is either kneeling or bowing her head. In this illustration, the annunciation is one-sided, not mutual. The angel Gabriel is somewhat domineering as delivering this news to Mary from above. And if this scene were put into a motion picture, many directors would choose to add some sound effects to the voice of the angel Gabriel to make the announcement sound holy and somewhat like otherworldly. Mary looks low, physically and spiritually, creating a stark contrast to the lofty Gabriel. As often sung in a carol, Mary is depicted to be meek and mild. Mary is the passive receiver of the announcement, so the tone of her, "Here am I, servant of the Lord," is frail and even trembling. Mary obeys God's will. She accepts her fate decided by God. Her fear and worry are secondary and even insignificant in this grand salvation history designed by God. I had read and translated this passage more than I could remember. But this time, preparing for today, my context has changed. I'm a new mother, as all of you know, and I found out I was pregnant only a few months after when Roe v. Wade was overturned. Also, I live in a state where my choice over my female body can be challenged, limited, and even taken away. Mary's obedience has been used as a theological and biblical foundation to justify the reality that many women in a state like Texas are now facing. Indeed, obedience is the virtue many theologians have praised about the Virgin Mary. This time, I couldn't get myself out of one simple question. Is Mary really meek and mild? According to whom is her obedience praiseworthy? I desperately wanted to find a different tone in Mary's voice, given all my context, because I still believed this beautiful story could bring me and people like me good news. I had to defy any possible condescending tone in this story. And it was the last verse that caught my eyes again. "Here am I, servant of the Lord, let it be with me according to your word." How would you read "let it be with me"? In what tone? Here's what came across as fresh and eye-opening to me this time. Some might read this "let it be" in a little bit like cynical and even self-deprecating manner, like Mary is obedient to the point of giving up her own agency and not really caring about whatever is going to happen. But here's one of my exegetical insights. You may guess this verb would be in the third person singular imperative form, as in English, "let it." But in Greek, this verb is in the mood that occurs only 68 times in the entire New Testament. It's called optative, which is used to express a desire or wish of the speaker. So I think "may it be so" is a more literal translation of this verb, more explicitly revealing Mary's own willingness. She is expressing her willingness to be part of God's great plan. Mary is willingly choosing to work with God by bearing a child as a virgin. So Mary's tone here is not defeated or timid. Instead, I hear Mary respond to Gabriel saying, "I'm in." She embraces her role as a co-worker of God with courage and faith. And this tone of Mary changes the tone of Gabriel as well. God, through Gabriel, invites Mary to this holy task. And Gabriel doesn't gloss over how difficult this task will be. Mary's perplexed, but she is not dismissed. Gabriel says to her, "Do not be afraid, for you have found favor with God." Mary is curious, but she's not dismissed. Gabriel answers her question, "How can this be?" with kindness and empathy. For nothing will be impossible with God. Gabriel is not forcing Mary, but gently asking her, saying, "Are you in?" Gabriel's tone is not patronizing or overpowering, but comforting and empowering. There, this annunciation becomes an invitation towards consent, not a one-sided command. It is disappointing, but not surprising, that most English translations are not interested in conveying the courageous and determined tone when Mary says, "May it be so with me according to your will." But we need to remember that if we fail to acknowledge Mary's consent to be part of God's salvation history, we are making our God just a watchmaker who controls and uses everything and everyone, including the bodies of God's beloved creation, just as God pleases. I personally can't think of a God who creates and takes care of a multitude of people behaving like teenagers, pressing Mary to get pregnant and bear a child. I don't know how you feel about it, but my God never mansplains to me, to Mary, or to anyone. Instead, God works amongst us and within us as the dwelling spirit, inviting, empowering, and encouraging us. God is my parent and my companion in that way. It was a few weeks into our new role as parents. We were tired and I was overwhelmed, trying to rest as much as I could to recover and trying to care for a newborn, a whole new realm of knowledge and experience. One day we were joking to each other, "How many poopy diapers do you think Joseph and Mary changed? Like, how many hours of sleep do you think they got?" And my spouse said, "It is almost a tragedy that men have dominated theological discourses. I don't know if any man will be able to fully understand what it means that a God became a human through the body of a woman and what it takes." I know my spouse is pretty cool, and that's why I married him. I'm sure Mary knew it was not an easy job when she agreed and chose to be part of God's history by bearing a son as a virgin. She knew her role would not be simply to give her body to be used as the vessel for the birth of Jesus. Truly, her saying yes to this annunciation changed the whole life, the rest of her life. She persisted in nursing and nurturing Jesus. And moreover, she persisted to the point of enduring pain as watching her son die on a cross. Mary is holy, not just because she is an obedient, naive girl. For me, Mary is holy because she is a co-worker of God who models boldness and persistence. You might say Mary could be exceptionally bold and persistent because she was special as God's favored one. And here's another exegetical insight from me today. The Greek word for favor in this passage is the word that is translated as grace elsewhere in the New Testament, even in the Gospel of Luke. Yes, God's grace was upon Mary, but don't we believe that God's grace is upon everyone, upon me and upon you? And you are sitting here in Christ Chapel today because you also responded to God's invitation. When gently asked, "Are you in?" you answered, "I'm in." I know for some of you, it took a while to finally say, "I'm in," but you anyway did, and you are here. You chose this not easy path to faithfully live as a servant of the Lord. So this day we celebrate the most sacred announcement in our faith. I want to remind you of Mary's choice that she willingly made by saying, "May it be so." Of her boldness and persistence that opened a radically new way to salvation. And also of God's presence among us as the dwelling, empowering Spirit. And most of all, I want to remind you of that gentle invitation that each one of us got from God. "Are you in?" And of the moment you responded saying, "I'm in." Are you in?
Amen.
May it be so, in the name of our triune God, who creates, who loves, and who nurtures. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand as we are able, and before we do the prayers of the people, let us, in our own language, affirm our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed on page 48 of your booklet. Page 48 in the language of your heart. Creemos en un solo Dios, Padre Todopoderoso, Creador del cielo y de la tierra, de todo lo visible e invisible. Creemos en un solo Señor Jesucristo, Hijo único de Dios, nacido del Padre antes de todos los siglos, Dios de Dios, luz de luz, Dios verdadero de Dios verdadero, engendrado, no creado, a la misma naturaleza que el Padre, por quien todo fue hecho, que por nosotros y por nuestra salvación bajó del cielo. Por obra del Espíritu Santo, se encarnó de María la Virgen y se hizo humano. Por nuestra causa, fue crucificado en tiempos de Poncio Pilato. Padeció y fue sepultado. Resucitó al tercer día, según las Escrituras. Subió al cielo y está sentado a la derecha del Padre. De nuevo vendrá con gloria para juzgar a vivos y muertos, y su reino no tendrá fin. Creemos en el Espíritu Santo, Señor y Dador de vida, que procede del Padre y del Hijo, que con el Padre y el Hijo recibe una misma adoración y gloria, y que habló por los profetas. Creemos en la Iglesia, que es una santa, católica y apostólica. Reconocemos un solo bautismo para el perdón de los pecados. Esperamos la resurrección de los muertos y la vida de un mundo futuro. Amén. En paz oremos al Señor diciendo, Señor, ten piedad.
For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Señor, ten piedad.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Señor, ten piedad.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples. We pray to you, O Lord. For those in positions of public trust, that we may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person. We pray to you, O Lord. For all who study in this community, especially Genesis Gomez and Jennifer Murphy, we pray to you, O Lord. For all who labor to further the mission of the seminary, especially Dr. G. Hay Park, we pray to you, O Lord. With thankful hearts and the blessings of this day, we pray to you, O Lord. For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, especially Donna, Marty, Joseph and family, Mo, Joyce, Brian, David, Manuel Ramos, Yvette Ramos, Nathan Jennings, Amy, Lorraine Coffey, and Conchita. For our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health. We pray to you, O Lord. For all who have died in the communion of your church, especially Corky Foster and Linda Emerald, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints, they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord, our God.
Señor, atiende las súplicas de tu pueblo y lo que fielmente te hemos pedido, concede que efectivamente lo obtengamos para la gloria de tu nombre, mediante Jesucristo nuestro Señor. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor in the language of your heart. Confesemos nuestros pecados contra Dios y contra nuestro prójimo. Dios de misericordia, confesamos que hemos pecado contra ti, en pensamiento, palabra y obra, por lo que hemos hecho y lo que hemos dejado de hacer. No te hemos amado con todo el corazón, no hemos amado a nuestro prójimo como a nosotros mismos. Sincera y humildemente nos arrepentimos, por amor de tu Hijo Jesucristo, ten piedad de nosotros y perdónanos. Así tu voluntad será nuestra alegría, y andaremos en tus caminos, para gloria de tu nombre. Amén. Dios omnipotente, tenga misericordia de ustedes. Perdone todos sus pecados por Jesucristo nuestro Señor. Les fortalezca en todo poder y bondad, y con el Espíritu Santo les conserve en la vida eterna.
Amén.
La paz del Señor sea siempre con ustedes.
La paz.
Thank you.
Señor sea con ustedes. Elevemos los corazones. Demos gracias a Dios nuestro Señor. En verdad es digno, justo y saludable darte gracias en todo tiempo y lugar, Padre omnipotente, Creador del cielo y de la tierra. Porque en el misterio del Verbo hecho carne, tú has hecho que una luz nueva brille en nuestros corazones para darnos el conocimiento de tu gloria en la faz de tu Hijo, nuestro Señor Jesucristo. Por tanto, te alabamos, uniendo nuestras voces con los ángeles y arcángeles y con todos los coros celestiales, que proclamando la gloria de tu nombre, por siempre cantan este himno. Padre santo y bondadoso, en tu amor infinito nos hiciste para ti, y cuando caímos en pecado y quedamos esclavos del mal y de la muerte, tú en tu misericordia enviaste a Jesucristo, tu Hijo único y eterno, para compartir nuestra naturaleza humana, para vivir y morir como uno de nosotros y así reconciliarnos contigo, el Dios y Padre de todos. Extendió sus brazos sobre la cruz y se ofreció en obediencia a tu voluntad. Un sacrificio perfecto por todo el mundo. En la noche en que fue entregado al sufrimiento y a la muerte, nuestro Señor Jesucristo tomó pan y dándote gracias lo partió y lo dio a sus discípulos y dijo: tomen y coman. Este es mi cuerpo entregado por ustedes. Hagan esto como memorial mío. Después de la cena, tomó el cáliz y dándote gracias, se lo entregó y dijo: beban todos de él. Esta es mi sangre del nuevo pacto, sangre derramada por ustedes y por muchos para el perdón de los pecados. Siempre que lo beban, háganlo como memorial mío. Por tanto, proclamamos el misterio de fe. Cristo ha muerto, Cristo ha resucitado, Cristo volverá. Padre, en el sacrificio de alabanza y acción de gracias, celebramos el memorial de nuestra redención. Recordando su muerte, resurrección y ascensión, te ofrecemos estos dones. Santifícalos con tu Espíritu Santo. Y así serán para tu pueblo el cuerpo y la sangre de tu Hijo, la santa comida y la santa bebida de la vida nueva en Él que no tiene fin. Santifícanos también para que seamos fielmente este santo sacramento y seamos perseverantes en tu servicio en paz y unidad. Y en el día postrero, llévanos con todos tus santos al gozo de tu reino eterno. Todo esto te pedimos por tu Hijo Jesucristo, por Él y con Él y en Él. En la unidad del Espíritu Santo, tuyo son el honor y la gloria, Padre omnipotente, ahora y por siempre.
Amén.
Y ahora oremos como nuestro Salvador Cristo nos enseñó. Aleluya, Cristo nuestra Pascua se ha sacrificado por nosotros. Los dones de Dios para el pueblo de Dios. Esta es la mesa del Señor y aquí toda persona es bienvenida.
Thank you.
Oremos. Eterno Dios, Padre Celestial, en tu bondad nos has aceptado como miembros vivos de tu Hijo, nuestro Salvador Jesucristo. Nos has nutrido con alimento espiritual en el sacramento de su cuerpo y de su sangre. Envíanos ahora en paz al mundo, de fuerza y de valor, para amarte y servirte con alegría y sencillez de corazón. Por Cristo nuestro Señor. Amén. Y la bendición de Dios, Padre, Hijo y Espíritu Santo, esté con ustedes ahora y por siempre.
Amén.
Vayamos en paz para amar y servir al Señor. Aleluya, aleluya.
So.